City Council Finance Committee meeting here November 27th. Bonnie Jo, would you be kind enough to read the roll?
Councilor Kimball?
Present.
Councilor Kelcourse?
Here.
Councilor Lavoy?
Here.
Councilor McMillan?
Present.
Councilor McClure?
Here.
Councilor Scorzoni?
Here.
Councilor Ferguson?
Present.
Councilor Gilday?
Present.
And Councilor Neal?
Present.
All present.
Thank you. You know, before we get started into the official agenda, Council President, I'm going to call on the Council President to have a few words.
Good evening, everybody. I'm glad to see so many people here tonight on this important meeting. Before we start our actual meeting, I would like to bring to your attention and congratulate the Amesbury High School football team for their successful victory last Thursday against Newburyport at the Landry Stadium. They beat Newburyport 13-10, and right now as we speak they are in Lowell at the semifinals, and we wish them all good luck, and we should be hearing sometime tonight whether they've made it or not to the Super Bowl. On more serious matter, we are very saddened to hear about a friend of Amesbury and a local citizen in Amesbury, Richard Newton, who passed away suddenly last week, and we, if possible, like to take a moment of silence to remember him. Thank you very much. Councilor Neal?
Thank you. First item on the agenda is 2012-091, Adopt Stretch Energy Code in the City of Amesbury. Council Scorzoni and Council President Ferguson and Council Lavoy are the sponsors. However, we've had a wonderful development tomorrow night. Council, if you'd like to give a
commercial,
about the meeting, I think that would be appropriate.
Sure thing. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Tomorrow at 7 o'clock here at Town Hall, Wednesday, November 28th, the Energy Task Force will be hosting an information session on the Stretch Energy Code. It's an item before us at the council level. The goal is to have a number of experts come and present to both the council and the public about what the adoption of the Stretch Code would actually entail. What the requirements are, what the benefits are. We're going to have some folks from Department of Energy Resources come and present on the Green Communities Program and what that means. The Stretch Code is a component of that program. And then we're also going to have some home builders walk through the code and talk about the utility incentives that are also behind some of this activity. And then we're going to have some folks from Newburyport, our sister city next door, talk about their experience with the code, and we'll have some others there as well. So I encourage the public to come and be part of this this public information session, ask questions. Hopefully we'll have a good panel, a good discussion, and hope to see everybody there tomorrow. Thank you. 7 o'clock.
Thank you. And as you folks can hear, Council is going to have an opportunity tomorrow to learn an awful lot about the economics of the program, and so we won't belabor the point tonight. And so I'll ask someone to make a motion to table this to our next Finance Committee.
So moved.
Second?
I'll second.
Thank you, Bob. Any discussion? All those in favor? All those opposed? Looks unanimous, Bonnie. And we're going to move along to 2012-092, Annual Classification Hearing. Mayor Keyser is the sponsor. The summary, on an annual basis, the City Council must vote on the issue of selecting a residential factor which will determine the percentage of the burden to be borne by each class of property. Mayor Keyser. It's either you or Mary, or both. A tag team. Surely you're not going to send Eric up.
No, we'll give Eric a little time.
Gets a pass.
I'm going to send Mary up, who's going to come in and go through the worksheet that's in front of you. go through all the numbers, and then I'm sure you'll have questions.
Excuse me, Mary Marino, assessor for the community of Amesbury, city of Amesbury. We're here this evening to discuss...
Mary, excuse me, could you speak into the microphone a little bit better, please?
I think you might.
Thank you so much.
The issues this evening are to discuss the four votes that the community takes on a yearly basis. The first is the selection of a residential factor, and in the paperwork I sent you, a vote for a factor of one would allow a single tax rate. And the second one is an open space discount. The Board of Assessors does not do any open space in the community. The third vote is regarding a residential exemption, and I make note there that the average residential value for this year is $254,465. Yeah. If the community, the council were to vote this exemption, it would be a reduction of up to $50,893 on values less than $254,000. Problem with this issue is that any property owners over $254,000 absorb the cost of that. So the fact that the property is already lower, and then any values over $254,000 has to pick up that. It has to be borne within the residential sector, yes. And the board does not ever recommend that. And the small commercial exemption, the fourth issue there, is basically the same thing. We would have to go through a process of number of employees that the Department of Training sends us yearly and establish a value. And again, so you have a small commercial business that has 12 employees, he may not be eligible, but a larger business that has 8 employees would be eligible, and therefore, once again, that smaller business owner would have to pick up that cost. So again, the board does not recommend that. On the second page, I've done the average values between last year and this year. And you can see pretty much most of our residential values have gone down. Condominiums, once again, took a very large hit again this year. They're down 8.90%. Two families are down 5.5, three families 5.1, apartments 1.78. The commercial industrial, it does say that they went up. However, I do want to clarify, we did not change any tables on our commercial and industrial. That increase is due basically to new growth and new businesses. So the average commercial, if I were to pull a commercial condominium, for instance, downtown, that value did not change. We did not change those tables. But when we're talking averages, they're always misleading. And so I don't want a lot of the commercial people thinking their values are going up 5%. Most, unless there was a building permit or some structural changes, most commercial values stayed the same. Our new commercial. The new growth is broken down as follows. The residential new growth amounted to 149,084. Commercial industrial new growth was 170,000 for a total of $319,328. On page 3, I have the estimated tax rates. If we went with a factor of 1, and I did it a shift of 5, 10, 15, and 20%. At a factor of 1, I wanted to note that the average single-family property tax bill will increase by approximately $128. That's a single-family home. However, at a factor of 1, the average residential property will increase by $73. So I took everything for that average residential. That would include apartments, two-family, three-family, condos, everything, where the first line is just single families. Page 4, again, is just showing the shift between this year and last year. And then I have the calculations, what we were allowed to raise, the debt exclusion. The total levy capacity was $37.7 million. where our estimated levy is 35.9, so we have an excess levy capacity of $1.8 million. And that's it, unless you have any questions.
Thank you. Councilors? Yes.
I guess is it possible to find out exactly what the new growth entails? I don't know, Mary, if you're the appropriate person to answer that question.
I'm sorry, I'm having a hard time hearing.
Sorry. Is it possible to get a better picture of what this new growth entails?
Actual new growth.
Actual new growth?
What is it?
Sorry.
What is new growth?
No, no. What are we seeing in the community as new growth? Is it?
New single-family homes, a condominium, a new condo complex that's, you know, a duplex type thing that's been condoed. If I went out to your house and you added a deck, that's growth. If new kitchens, you know, any building permits that play into the valuation of a property increases, that's where we get our new growth.
But I guess, so on the commercial side, are you looking at building permits? Can you tell us, what does that look like roughly? Are we seeing new businesses? How many businesses? What kind of businesses?
Well, we're certainly seeing new businesses. I mean, the first one I'm thinking of is out on 110 on Haver Road, where the car washes. They opened a little variety store and a Heavenly Donuts.
Right.
Yes, that's considered all new growth. That building, the personal property in that building, all of that is. There's a perfect example of what new growth is. Eastern Lumber sold last year or 2 years ago. We went out, they had pulled some building permits, upgraded, you know, done some interior renovations. That's new growth.
Okay. Great. Thank you, Mary.
Also, Amesbury Chevrolet with the additions and modernization that was, you know, of course, they could be paying more taxes for that, you know, updating their property.
Based on the briefings that I'm getting from Dennis Nato, who's the recipient of most of these permits, where we saw a trend over a few years ago during the economic decline, we saw an increase in number of permits, but they were for a lot smaller projects. So what was happening is people were renovating kitchens and basements and things of that sort, those type of projects, rather than any large construction. That trend seems to be changing, where Dennis has indicated that we're seeing a lot more full building permits. There are a number of houses that are newly constructed or under construction in Amesbury, so we're seeing some of these bigger projects going through. And then for Mary, we talked about the hospital and the Spahawk School. Were both real estate transactions for large buildings, whereas the buildings were non-taxable properties bought by private entities that are now taxable. So both the former Amesbury Hospital and the location at the Spahawk School, both those buildings came on, show up as new growth, expansion in that. So we are seeing the trend of larger projects, real construction building projects, rather than a lot of home improvement type projects.
Yeah, I just while Mary cited on page 2 the income or increased taxes for the new growth, if you look to the left, you'll see the total dollars of construction, and the total sum total of construction is, in round numbers, $16,700,000 that was spent in this community. $8,900,000 commercial and $7,800,000 residential. And I mean, that's really reflective of the level of growth in our community. So this past fiscal year, people spent close to $17 million here in town. Well, that produces a grand total of, again, in round numbers, $319,000 new dollars in taxes paid by individuals who increase the value of their properties in some way, shape, form, or manner. In And if you recall at budget time, we try to estimate what the new growth is going to be. And I know Mary and her staff are at budget time feverishly trying to certify the fact that these people have made their investments.
And what was that number, Alan?
I think we were around, we were hoping for around, I forget if it's 350 or 400,000. That number sticks in my head as what our target was. Is that, Michael?
400.
400, yeah. So we hit 319 out of the 400,000 goal.
So we're off quite a bit?
We're off 100,000. Well, we're 80, off 80,000.
80,000.
And that's revenues.
20%.
Yeah. That's revenues.
Could have been worse.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
May I ask you a question?
Surely.
To reduce the dollar per thousand amount, you would have to reduce the budget by $1.8 million. Is that correct, roughly?
The dollar, yeah. Dollar on the budget, about $1.8 million. Well, maybe a little less. The rate went down. What was the total?
$1,774,000.
Thank you very much.
Say it again.
$1,774,000. Yeah. It would take $1,774,000 dollars, either reduction or increase, that change the tax rate by a dollar.
Per thousand.
Yeah.
May I ask another question, Mr.
Sure.
Chairman? And this question would be of Mike Bask.
By the way, that could be found, okay. I'm sorry, on page 4 of the document that we handed out. In the general information, mm-hmm. you can see the for fiscal year 2013, the new total value in town, which is $1,774,000. But when you take the thousand off of it, makes it $1,774,000.
To reduce a dollar, you'd be reducing an effect. You would have to reduce the budget by $1.774 million.
Million, that's correct.
Million, yes.
Million, yeah.
Okay. Yep. May I ask a question of Mr. Bask?
Sure.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Bask. My question to you would be, what would be the effect, and I know we have this discussion every year around this time of the setting of the rate, but what would be the effect of using free cash to offset, you know, some of the tax, the per dollar per thousand increase that we are, you know, talking about here today, whether to make that recommendation to the City Council? What would be the effect of using some of our certified free cash, because we've certified, per this report, per the mayor's memorandum to us, 1.274 million dollars in certified free cash?
My opinion as to what the effects of that is?
Yes.
Well, what you'd be doing is, you're basically underfunding your budget when you do that, because you'd be taking that one-time revenue source and substituting it from the, you'd be inserting that into the budget, so thereby lowering your taxes by that amount, but mm-hmm. it's a one-time revenue source. And once you do that, then next year, you're already, however much you would use, if you wanted to use $1.2 million or if you wanted to use $500,000, you're that much, whatever that dollar amount is, you're already behind, out of balance in your budget by that dollar.
You've already created a tax increase for the next fiscal year.
Unless you
lowered the expenses
exactly
in the following
correct.
Year.
And thank you, Councilor McMillan, for bringing that up, because we had some items that came up after the fact, police and fire, that we funded later on, that, you know, we, per our administration and some of the other members of the council here and so forth, because of negotiations, we couldn't address at budget time. So that amount wasn't accounted for when we were addressing the budget this year, but came in after the fact, so we really couldn't do anything about it. So I think it's something that maybe we should consider, using some of that free cash to offset. I'm not talking all of it, because if you need $1.8 million to reduce by 1,000, we've essentially gone up 1.11, so we've, no, million, but $1.11. on the tax rate from 1913 and suggesting, we haven't done it yet, but suggesting going up from 1913 to $20.24 per thousand. So if we were to use half of that, 1.274 in free cash, you know, we could save the taxpayers a 50 cent per dollar per thousand increase, you know, this year in taxes, and I'm sure the average of $128 or $74 on average citywide would at least come down somewhat. That's true, right?
It's true. The numbers are true, yes. You asking for my opinion on that?
Sure.
My opinion is that would not be the correct thing to do. The tax levy that is this evening, the tax levy that we are presenting to you is actually less than what was presented to the council when we presented the budget. So the levy is no different than where we knew it was going to be. It's a little bit less.
I saw that actually right here on the budget.
Using free cash to lower the levy is nothing that I would ever recommend that you do. It's just not sound financial practice. I think you've seen that other communities, some do, some don't. We're always talking about bond ratings and wanting to improve our reserves and what have you, but that's really not the correct way to go by applying it towards your tax.
Let's say for argument's sake, what would be the effect, okay, if we used half of our excess certified levy, excess certified free cash or certified free cash to offset, for instance, the proposed increase by half, and then next year we address some of the increases that we, you know, allowed after the fact, for instance, to the police and fire, say, well, look at folks, you've got a department heads, we might want to talk to you about sharpening your pencils a little bit more and coming to us with an adjusted, you know, I know we all say that we couldn't find it at budget time, but there were some increases that we, of course, didn't account for at budget time that came in after the fact due to contract negotiations. So, you know, wouldn't that therefore, you know, help us offset that amount of free cash that we used to stick in there for this year, and wouldn't, you know, increase it so much? Do you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, I do. I understand, and I can see where it's very tempting to do. Once again, it wasn't easy for you to make those reductions last year,
no.
And I wouldn't imagine that next year it's going to be really any easier to do that. I'd hate to be in a position where you already have to reduce a half million before you even get started to make up for that perhaps half million of free cash that you had.
Excuse, can I, first off, the increase in revenues over the previous fiscal year is only in the $300,000 rate. To be taking a half a million dollars is actually reducing the tax rate. And so not only wouldn't we be covering the costs, we'd actually be reducing the revenues relative to the current day costs. So we would have a huge tax increase built into the next fiscal year already. Unless
we cut spending.
Unless you can find a half a million dollars to cut spending. Unless, I appreciate the sentiment, but please. So tonight, that's not what we're here to do. Tonight we're here to talk about classification. And you know, we had the same kind of a pattern of discussion the last fiscal year. We adopt the budget in June. If you were to try to take these cuts that you're proffering against the budget, which has gone through, what, 5 months? 5 months? You basically be doubling up. So if you're asking for a 10% cut, we would have to cut the remaining part of the year 20%. I don't think we have 20% in dollars that, you know, we have the ability to cut. In other words, most all of the dollars that we have in the budget are fixed costs. So
I understand that.
What we're discussing here is a little bit off target, and we should really get back to sticking to the selection of the residential factor. Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
I'd just like to add one thing to remind the council and the audience out there, that we had a one-time hit this year of approximately $400,000 for the extra pay period that we have. Is that correct, Mike?
Yeah.
Yeah. So without that hit, it would have affected the, you know, the tax rate more favorably than having to come up with another $440,000.
It really wouldn't, because if you recall, we did use free cash for that purpose, because we knew it was a one-time incident, so we said we're recommending that we apply that $400,000. It is an increase in the budget, but it is offset by that free cash because it was a one-time. So in fact, we are using $400,000 of free cash. That was the prior year's free cash, though, that this 1.2 is the new certified amount as of July.
All right, thank you.
Yes, Donna.
Last June at budget time, I had a discussion with the council, and I had asked that we stick with freezing the spending at last year's rate. And we could not find $10,000 to cut from the budget.
Well,
right?
We did, but.
Oh, $10,000 we found to cut?
We did.
Okay, so we cut $10,000 out of a $51 million budget?
$30,000.
I think we cut to.
Yeah, 30 or 40.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So we couldn't find any more money. Yet year after year after year, I sit here and we, at the end of the year, have 900,000, I think you said last year, a million the year before that. And I just want to remind everyone that this is their money. This isn't free cash, there's nothing free about it. This is money that we put into the budget. And obviously we are over budgeting, because we do have 1.2 million at the end of every year. Now I hear that the DOR recommends that we do that to the tune of 5%, but the DOR does not realize what a position Amesbury is in. We are number six in tax rate, and I know we're not supposed to discuss this, it's classification, but I think the people that are here tonight are here because they saw $1.11 increase in their tax bill, so I believe that's why some of the folks here have shown up. I'm not.
It may be, and we can deal with that. But tonight, our job is to take up the issue of the selection of a residential factor, an open space discount, a residential exemption, and commercial exemptions. And this topic is really more suited for a vote down the line at the council about how we want to cover costs, not tonight. We're not dealing with that issue tonight. Any other questions about the residential factor, open space discount?
You got another question?
Yes.
So tonight's discussion is whether or not we want to have a split tax rate, essentially.
That is correct.
That's right. The only discussion we're here to have?
That is this particular agenda item, that's correct.
One of three.
Yeah. Thank you. Any other comments? Residents, let's see. Mike Buto, you wanted to speak on assessments and tax rates. Come on up, Mike. And just for everybody, please identify yourself, where you live, et cetera.
Mike Buto, 10 Cabot Court, Amesbury.
Thank you.
Councilor, I'm to understand that all remarks should be
too close? Is it me?
No.
Hold on. Phone? Does that help?
Coming back.
We need our expert over there.
Electronics.
No, we're still getting it.
Okay. Patrick, see if you can adjust the.
Fix it.
Councilor, I'm to understand that all remarks are to be limited to discussion of the potential of a split tax rate. Is that correct?
That is correct. That is
okay.
What the subject matter is.
Okay. Then.
It will give you leeway, but.
Well, I'll forego my originally intended remarks simply to say that after coming to meetings and watching on television and on the web for several years, it's distressing that the time to have a detailed discussion of what needs to be reduced in terms of our spending is never now. It's always sometime down the road. And I think that the council has to make more clear to the residents when a good time to have that detailed discussion of what needs to be cut, because things do need to be cut, so that when we do show up, we're coming to the right meetings. Thank you.
I appreciate your comment. You. And just to reiterate, the month of May and June, we hold budget hearings. At those budget hearings, and we have a few people here, Jane is always here, and so is Claude, and I applaud them for being here. And Mike, that is the appropriate time to come here and talk about the costs. So when we approve that, we approve the numerator in the tax rate. So if we're going to reduce costs, you should come here, sit and listen to what the department heads have put together, take a look at the line items like we do. And I know my compatriots would love to hear anybody's particular view on how we could cut a cost. I mean that sincerely. Because at the end of the day, once we've put our check mark next to it, it means that, and I think these folks will attest to, they have done the hard homework to make sure that we need to spend those dollars. I wish it weren't true. I wish there was this big pile of money that we could just X out, but Donna was correct. After sitting around, all we could come up with was $30,000, and that is how tight the department heads, frankly, have budgeted. Thank you. Next speaker is Martin. I'm sorry, Martin, will you help me with your last name?
Ruzak.
Ruzak. Thank you.
I'm Martin Ruzak. I live at 12 Cabot Court. I just had a general comment because I don't come here that often, so I didn't know what would be particular topic of the discussion, but I just wanted to voice my concern as a homeowner about the local taxes as we moved here from Midwest, originally from Europe. And I didn't realize when we were looking at the places where to live that this would be an important thing. Now I realize because number one, that the number keeps on increasing every year. And I work as a physician, I work in a different town, and thinking about moving now is a problem because the real estate agent mentioned initially that the taxes may be a little bit higher here, but I didn't pay much attention to it. But now I do because our property suffers from that because when I'm trying to sell the house, the real estate agent will say the same thing, or maybe even worse, for this year. So that's my concern that I wanted to voice tonight.
Appreciate that. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Jim, is it this topic that you wanted to voice your concerns on?
Absolutely.
Please come up.
I've given you a pretty considerable package to look at between now and your meeting in December where you'll actually decide the issue. You know, the importance of disclosing the close of business for the fiscal year never becomes more important now when you hear these figures. We're standing here and we do not have the recap sheet. We don't have the picture. We're talking about shifting the burden before we understand all of the elements that make up this whole tax rate equation. To my knowledge, they're not available. All right, I'm going to give you an example. When we went from 1846 to 1913, that was like a 67-cent increase. Now, according to the DOR, the comparative report for 2012, that translated into 600,000 more in receivables, as I brought out, but 90,000 of that was foreclosure. There's 890,000 in foreclosures. Now, I track this stuff. I'm about 2 or 3 months behind. But I have seen in 2011, calendar, and 2012, properties, at least one, that was bought low and sold for 100 grand 3 months later. People are making a killing on these foreclosed properties, and they're making it here, all right? Now, I have expressed my disconcertation with the council's policies, ordinance to pay long-term debt with these kinds of receivables. Here's the problem. This is going a buck 11. So let's do a little proration here. If you go up 67 cents and you generate 600,000 more, 90,000 more in foreclosures, what do you think this is going to do? I express my concern on the way this budget was done at the time, June 19th. Free cash includes general fund, water, sewer, and Landry funds. You can take all that free cash and aggregate it. I see nothing in the statutes that tells us we cannot. Water retained earnings is free cash. Water free cash. But it is free cash. And I put in that package the 2010 certification of free cash. Now, I have proposed during the budget session that we use the receipts that the unions negotiated, the teachers specifically, to offset. I haven't seen the recap sheet. I believe it's not there, all right?
Okay.
So we're talking about a residential factor. This is the purpose of this meeting, to establish a residential factor, all right? A factor of one leaves everything the same. If you use 101, if you increase it one, you're gonna drop that tax rate, residential, 4 cents, okay? So if you drop it, if you go to 110, that's 40 cents you'll drop it, all right? Now, we know from these figures that commercial, it looks like it, I'll stand corrected, that both commercial and industrial values went up, all right? Now, I'm proposing that you look at that figure, 120, 110 to 120, even 130, if necessary, to drop it. Because when you take money out of the economy, what happens? You reduce demand. The purpose of all of this stuff going on now in this fiscal crisis is not to implode this economy. There are 20,000 cities, I believe, cities and towns. You know, we're 120,000. We're not doing our part. I don't think they did a good job during the budget. Not at all. It can be reduced. There's no question. So I would like the council to do a number of things. To consider to use a residential factor of 110, 120, whatever you feel comfortable with. So if it's 110, multiply that 10 by 4. And that residential rate will come down from 2024 to 1984. All right? I can't give you the computation on that business tax. But we got to do something. You're taking money out of the economy. You're creating receivables. Those people are buying short. And they're killing this place. And it all boils down to one thing.
Don't bang.
This is my conclusion. It's not so much of the budget. When you have declining population, declining school enrollment, when you have monies going out, sending tuition for both charter and general school, it boils down to one thing: lack of leadership.
Thank you.
That's it. So if he can't provide it, you gotta provide it. And you better start. Somebody's gotta start. Because if it continues like this, get him out of here.
Thank you, Jim. Are there any other? Yes, there is. Melissa LaChance.
Hello, Melissa LaChance, 5 North Hunt Road, and also the Executive Director of the Amesbury Chamber of Commerce. I just wanted to comment that I am in strong support of the single tax rate because I feel that it's fair for businesses and residents. We at the Chamber feel that it helps grow the business community and increase the economic development in the city. I think the growth of businesses is good for the whole community as a whole. I'm in strong support of the single tax rate. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Melissa.
Claude?
Good evening. My name's Claude Gonti, 112 Kimball Road. Before I speak on the factor of classification, before you, there's some figures given out tonight and that were not exactly correct. The proposed new growth for budgetary purposes was based on new growth of $23 million. You came in at $16 million. It's 23% difference.
It was
over 400. Yeah. It was 420. I forget what it was, 1,000. But the valuation that it was based on was a $23 million increase. The other thing is in the mayor's cover letter, the reason the tax rate's going up is because declining values. This becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy. You don't like to hear people say that the taxes are too high here, but the market is saying the taxes are too high here, and that's reflected in your tax rate. So I think it's apropos to start thinking about if we have money surplus generated because of prior years over budgeting, that maybe the best use for that money would be to lower the tax rate and to two things, to give the poor taxpayer a break. The next 4 years don't look any rosier than the last 4 years. We're talking taxes coming out of Washington. I mean, we gotta start thinking about how this impacts people's lives. And it is impacting people's lives. And it's into our best interest also as a community to show that we are smart with our money and that we are gonna take a hard line on the budgets. And I don't think we do that. And I think people are losing hope. And again, that's reflecting in the real estate values. However, to the matter of classification, I'm in favor of a factor of one. Thank you.
Thank you, Claude. Karen Conti. Karen, if you wouldn't mind identifying yourself when you get up to the microphone for everybody.
Thank you.
Thank you.
My name is Karen Conti.
Speak into the microphone, please.
My name is Karen Conti. I live on Albion Street. I've been in this community exactly 6.5 years. I came here from Western Mass. I lived in Long Meadow. I came from a very lovely community. My daughter recommended Amesbury because it was an up-and-coming community, and it's very charming. Now, I need to tell you, I bought my condo in 2006. So we know what happened. I bought in the bubble. I have been unable to refinance because I pay my bills. I pay my taxes, and I do what I need to do for the community. Now, I understand that there may not be a lot of residents here this evening or there may not be a lot of residents at the municipal council meeting. But I think you folks have a very good understanding that those of us who work very hard may have to work two jobs to make ends meet. I did that for a long time, okay? So I was unable to attend the municipal council meeting earlier in the month. Actually in October. And it bothered me because I had the, I made sure I watched the council meeting on TV. And it was a little distressing to my spirit that I heard, and I could be incorrect, and I'm very willing to admit that, that the budget was approved without the council knowing all of the negotiations with collective bargaining. And trust me, I'm a nurse. I've been an RN in Massachusetts forever. I work in management now, so I don't belong to the collective bargaining. But in my understanding from what I gleaned from that meeting was that you folks did not have access to all of the collective bargaining pieces, so to speak. So we allowed a $10,000 stipend for the police and the firemen.
Education.
It's an education and stipend that the state of Massachusetts could not afford. So one of my questions to you folks is how can this community afford that? I don't know what it equates to in taxes, but I'm going to tell you from my perspective, it is a challenge to my spirit to see what we pay in taxes. And I understand that there's only so much you can do with a budget, but my hope was that you folks would step up to the plate and think about everybody in this community that works very hard to pay their bills and meet their expenses as you folks do in trying to help us live in this community, because it is very charming. But from my perspective, I need to tell you that I work very hard and have a long time, and this is a community that I chose to be in. But it is my hope that you look out for everybody in the community, even especially those that have to work very hard to meet their expenses and pay the taxes. And we are one of the highest tax rates in the state. And I truly am trying to be understanding of that. And I'm hoping you can explain that, not just to me, but just to the community. So, and I am truly grateful that you allow me the opportunity to come before you, because it is a lovely, lovely community. But I'm truly trying to understand the tax rate in this community.
Thanks very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Any further comments? Mr. Mayor?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just want to add my advocacy to the council for maintaining a single tax rate. We've been down this path before on this debate. The benefit to the single tax rate is, given the makeup of our commercial industrial sector, they are very, very much mom and pop operations, small operations that are not dependent on location for a great part.
and therefore a shift of the burden onto the commercial industrial would discourage the continuation of the growth that we are currently seeing. Communities such as, say, Danvers, that has a Liberty Tree Mall and a North Shore Mall, where there's a lot of brick and mortar stuck to the ground, are communities that are better suited to shift the burden and not worry about losing the business sector by doing so. In Amesbury, by the nature of our business structure, we would lose. And the benefit also of encouraging the growth in the commercial industrial sector is that is part of the solution of relief to the residential sector burden as we grow the commercial industrial base. What I also want to do is just provide some context to some numbers. As you've seen in my memo, I talk about the tax rate, but I also talk about tax bills, the amount that people have to pay on their taxes. If you recall, as a result of the budget that we approved, the bottom line of the overall budget increased by $1.2 million. Of that $1.2 million in increase, $369,000 is the amount covered by any tax increase. The balance of everything else is from either the new growth number, the $319,000, and other revenues such as ambulance receipts and those type of sources. So a $369,000 increase in the amount of taxes on a $35.9 million total levy is an increase of barely just a fraction over a 1% increase. Given that the economy is growing somewhere at 3% thereabouts, the fact is that we increased our taxable portion of our revenue by about a third of what inflation, of what we've been able to do. And again, that $369,000 is equivalent on the calculations with the current rate of about a 21-cent increase in the tax rate. The balance, the 90 cents of the tax rate increase, is simply due to the loss of $67 million in real estate values. So, to put it another way, if we did not raise taxes by that $369,000, our tax rate would still have gone up by 90 cents with no changes in what we're collecting in taxes. That results...
It would have been $20 and... Is it 3 cents?
$20.03 would have been the rate with no increase on the tax side.
Right.
There are winners and losers on as far as the impact. The lady who just spoke, unless you're living at Bartlett's Reach, the good news is I bet your taxes are going down. I'm pretty confident your taxes are going down. It's a double-edged sword because it's... Yeah. Yes. So there are properties who were able to maintain their values, their equity, and they will see an increase, and that's how it works out. But for that $369,000 increase in taxes, what did we get for it? Well, what we did in the budget, the increases in the budget, $600,000 of our increase went to schools, went to our education system. I don't know if anybody here is advocating to cut the school budget to deal with this issue. There's not a lot of, in fact, all the advocacy at the budget time was to increase that dollar amount. So we increased taxes $369,000. In return, we got $600,000 increase in schools. After we take away that one-time $400,000 payroll cost, which we covered with free cash, we increased the entire $25 million operations of the city side of the budget by $200,000. And that's by other fees. So in a context as far as managing our fiscal affairs, I think we have done an outstanding job. The challenge we have in Amesbury is the legacy of our, the makeup of our properties and values, in that they're susceptible to the gyrations in the marketplace. But as a municipality, those factors that we do control, all of us have done, I think, an outstanding job in that. One metric to look at, to compare with, if you want, all the communities of Massachusetts, is looking at the amount of our total taxes that we're taking in relative to the amount we are allowed, the maximum we are allowed under Proposition 2.5. And if you recall, the Mass Taxpayers Foundation puts out a report every December in which they show the number of municipalities who are taxing, are raising their, bringing their property taxes to the maximum allowed under 2.5. 75% of all municipalities in Massachusetts tax at that max levy. Some 5 years ago, Amesbury was at that same spot, where we had next to zero levy, excess levy capacity, meaning no difference between what we were raising and what the max. With this budget that we've already approved, we now have $1.8 million in levy capacity. Or for this year, off the top of my head, I think it was $466,000 of levy capacity that we created with this budget, meaning that we could have raised taxes and we were disciplined enough not to. When you rank the municipalities by dollars, using last year's figures, not even the improved new figures for this year, Amesbury is somewhere in the top 15 in the state of excess levy capacity, or in other words, the amount of dollars that we are raising taxes below the maximum allowed. And we've achieved that over the last 4 years. And that was done through discipline in our budgeting while also meeting the service needs of our community. And we've met that balance and have done well. So again, just to provide some context on those numbers, we on the change in the tax rate, the top number of the fraction, we increased $369,000. On the tax side, that accounted for 21 cents of the change. And we saw the total values drop by $66.9 million in the numerator of that calculation. And that is why we see the other 90 cents change in that. But on the average tax bill, overall, all residents, counting the condominiums and the apartments, complexes, the average property tax increase is $73 for the year. And that's with $600,000 increase in schools and the other services that we're providing. And the single family home would be $128,000 on the average. So that's the context. But in regard to the issue in front of you, I again strongly advocate maintaining a single tax rate. Thank you.
Any other? I'm going to charge you double the price.
Mr. Mayor, I truly appreciate all your comments and your context. And I say this with deep respect for what you've done for this community. I've voted for you 3 times, and I've cast every one of those votes with pride. I realize that you are very attentive to the financial status of this community. But I feel like I need to clarify something, and that is that When we talk about the amount of money that we have available to the town in terms of property tax revenues, what we're really talking about is legal access to revenue, okay? And That's the same as having a big credit card. Now, I have a $25,000 limit on my MasterCard, okay? But if I use all $25,000 of it, that's not good fiscal policy. Just because we have access to be able to tax people at a higher rate than we currently are doesn't make for sound fiscal policy. It's not good for the taxpayers, of which I'm one. Now, you brought up some other sort of ancillary issues, and I feel like I should comment on them as well. I mean, we do understand that it is the tax bill and not the rate that matters. But we also recognize that after a certain point, the rate, in fact, becomes a drag on our property values and our ability to alienate, in other words, to sell our homes. There's probably a psychological barrier there somewhere, but $20 seems like a big number, $20 per thousand. Since moving here in 2007, my wife and I have paid more than $50,000 in property taxes, and we've sadly come to the conclusion that that has not been money well spent. We are increasingly distressed at the unwillingness of the city to recognize the excessive burden that has been placed on homeowners. As reported,
does that
I think
mean
you're
advocating a something other than a factor of one?
I think that two things have to happen. I think that business owners need to pay a higher share as a percentage. I do not think that what has been going on the past few years with a balanced rate has acted as an incentive for people to locate their businesses here. I think most of the businesses here are, in fact, point of purchase type of businesses. You're not going to go, Stop and Shop wants access to people locally. You know, they put the Stop and Shop here because there's a big indigenous market, and because they're the only guys on the block. The point I wanted to make, though, is that, you know, as reported in the Daily News on Monday, the city is adding yet more administrators and costs to an already bloated school district, and we're paying steep fees for retired administrators to sit in on routine meetings. And this is at a time when, in all likelihood, the federal taxes are going to be rising in the coming year. And I think that sends absolutely the wrong message.
The federal taxes going up sends the wrong message? Or
I think that us raising, looking to raise or potentially raise more revenue, as I pointed out, I'm one of the higher taxpayers in the town. So this lies disproportionately on my family, on some of my neighbors who are here in the audience. You know, we can talk about average tax rates, but in no way, shape, or form is my property average.
And nor is mine.
So, well, you know, Councilor Neal, we've talked about this in the past. I've talked with Councilor Gilday, and I think that they would likely to attest that we, my wife and I, have been supportive of, if not always enthusiastic about, the city's budgetary decisions over the past several years. Over the past year, we have come to realize that there is an extraordinary amount of waste in the system, in particular in the school district. We firmly believe that Amesbury needs an across-the-board budget cut of at least 10% to demonstrate that we are serious about holding the line on spending and to force the department heads to shed their well-disguised slush funds. It's not without some angst.
You know, I'm going to, you're getting a little far afield.
Well,
but I urge you, Michael, I urge you to come to the budget hearings next fiscal year, because the statements that you made about slush funds, if they exist, this group of people didn't find them. And so I want you to help me find them.
I understand you didn't find them. So for example...
No, I want you to help me find them.
For example, what are the questions when we talk to the police department?
Could we let him finish, please?
Councilor?
When we talked to the police department in 2011, during those budget talks, the police presented a budget that purported to reduce expenses. Yet when the one-time buyout costs of the two retiring officers were subtracted, it was evident that they actually increased their allocation. In response, one of the counselors here suggested that the $73,000 budgeted for fuel costs for the police department might be trimmed if the officers drove their car less. Ultimately, the council approved the higher allocation request. I mean, that's just not going to cut it. Now, to the school department, you know, and please don't take this as criticism. I mean, none of us works for the city, and we recognize it's very difficult for outsiders to really be attuned to where the money's going, and that's why I think you need to make across-the-board cuts. The schools are no better. You know, we talked about, you know, the amount of money that, you know, had been allocated for different jobs, but I would point out we have two elementary schools with their own principals and building superintendents. You know, is it possible to consolidate that administration under Mr. Hellison and jettison the fat, so to speak? Thousands of taxpayer dollars were spent this summer on lawyers and other expenses to investigate and clean up a mess created by Cashman school administrators involving a single student. Wouldn't that money be better allocated to additional bureaucracy?
We're getting a far afield, and you shouldn't risk putting that kind of information out there if it isn't necessarily true. I don't have knowledge of it.
I understand you don't have knowledge of it. I understand
but
that.
But the appropriate place for that is at the school committee, not here.
This is the finance committee, correct? The finance committee allocates the money for those departments, correct?
We do not have purview over school department issues.
But you do have purview over their budgets, correct?
Actually, we only have purview over how much money we give them. That's it.
Right.
Yeah, we don't tell them how to spend it.
Well, to get a $1,500 reduction in the average household tax would mean dropping $9 million from the budget. That's the total allocation for the DPW, the library, the police, and the fire. Mm-hmm. So you cannot reasonably lower the actual taxes, not the tax rate, but the actual tax bill, without cutting the school department too. So speaking as one citizen, you can no longer say that nobody comes forward.
That was my comment about when we were talking about 20%. You're exactly correct. We don't have that type of number to cut. Yeah.
I appreciate everything that you do. I know that you have a difficult job. I appreciate you letting me speak.
Thank you very much. Yes, Jim.
May I follow up?
Quickly.
Quick. Thank you very much. I'm holding you to quick. We love poignant.
Here is, as I see, one of the many problems in this whole process. The denominator, the values, are 2011 values, so that when Ms. Marino refers to them as fiscal 12, okay, they underlie this net appropriation. Now, here's the problem here, and one of the many. That figure, all right, although not massaged, is available in that first week. Yet we only see this individual is about as interested as anybody in this stuff that I've ever known. The thing is, it is now 11/27, 2012. 11 months and 27 days since January, or 26 days since January 1st, and it's the first time seeing this value figure. That makes a difference. If you have that value, you know that direction, that dimension, then you should make your decisions accordingly, but you don't have it. So you are disturbed. Ask the administration to give it to you when it's available. January. The first working day in January. Now, here's the other thing. I want to just read one thing.
Just please don't bang. That's what sets the
Well, you know, I'm like this guy, all right? I didn't vote for him three times. I'd never vote for him. But here's a letter I got. I asked for the vendor list.
Just don't bang.
I asked for the vendor list, okay? And I did it publicly. The mayor's office is in receipt of your request for a copy of the city's vendor list. The complete list of vendors will be approximately 500 pages. Please submit a check for $125. Is that obstruction? Let me tell you something. I'm going to ask the council to make a free cash transfer to get a copy of this for me and everybody in this community to see. All right? And I'm going to close with this. I'm not on that guy's mailing list, but I am on the Federal Reserve's mailing list. And I want to, but this didn't come out of the Federal Reserve, it came out of the Wall Street Journal. 71% of consumer spending, okay, 71% of GDP is consumer spending, okay? Wall Street Journal, Council of the Commerce Department. What you are doing here, what in toto this government is doing is completely antithetical to what's supposed to be done. There's plenty of places where you can rearrange that budget. You got to know those values, January 2013.
Thank you.
First working day.
Thank you, Jim. Now, Mary, would you like to tell him when the state certified those numbers?
Just to clarify, I have to pick up new growth until July 1st of this year.
Yeah.
So, you know, we can't be everywhere on July 1st. So it takes us a couple of weeks. We're getting out there in June and July. Then we're going through all of our sales to make sure that our sales information is correct, so that if we think a house sold for $400,000 and it has 8 rooms and 3 bathrooms, that that information is correct. So the state of Massachusetts allows us until at least July 1st. That information is never, ever going to be available on January 1st of last year. It can't be.
Right.
So that's the first and foremost. Then we have the reval company come in, they do our work, we do our statistical analysis, and we submit to the state of Massachusetts. I believe I was not certified in my values until late October. Okay. I could check the date.
It's officially
for sure.
Available in October.
As soon as I receive notification, I let Mike know. It's usually late October, early November.
Thank you very much. Surely is not available in January.
Absolutely.
Thank you. You know, I've conducted such a poor meeting. I think you should.
I'll second it.
Wait,
can you get to the mic, please?
You have to use the mic.
Yeah. You got a big crowd out there.
I'm very grateful that I have this opportunity. It's not so much that I come here to you to complain. It's more that I come to you to explain that I'm your average person. I'm a single person, and my property probably is $50,000 underwater. I have not been able to refinance, so I have a very high interest rate, and it is my hope that when you folks come to this table, that you look at everybody's situation and that you will take into consideration that I know that it's tough trying to manage fiscal budgets. I have trouble managing mine, but it is my hope that you look at it globally and that you look at it from the standpoint that we would all like everything, but we cannot all have everything all the time. And again, I appreciate you listening to me because it is a very charming community. And I just hope you'll step up to the plate to look at that. Thank you.
Well, Mrs. Conti, you condos went down about 8.9%.
Yeah.
I think the average value reduction was around a little over 5%. So you are going to be receiving probably a reduction in your property taxes.
Right, but she can't refinance no matter how low it is.
I understand that, but that is not something that we control.
No, I'm understanding that it's
So I just wanted you to know that you're better than the average person in this community. In fact,
feeling lucky?
Yeah.
Be worse.
Thank you, though.
Thank you.
Any other comments from the community?
I just have a real
quick. Please identify yourself.
Sorry, my name is Bill Fogolski. I live in Mike Puto's neighborhood. I've been here for 3 years.
You live in
Cabot.
Cabot Street.
Cabot
Lane.
Address.
No, I live on Arbor Crest Road. What's the name of the neighborhood?
Merrimack Landing.
Yes, one of those. Long day. I just wanted to speak up. I'm sorry for my tardiness, but I also wanted to speak in favor. I'm also a property owner in Salem as well, where we enjoy the industry and commercial paying a higher tax rate. I know that there was one person that spoke up before that said they wanted to keep it the same because they're a local business. I strongly believe that this is a large point of purchase community. I, obviously because of our location in New Hampshire, there's not going to be a big box retailer moving in when tax-free is right across the state lines. I have yet to see a viable reason for the local businesses to leave there was a spread between the residential and the commercial and industry. So that's all I have.
Thanks very much.
That's it. Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. No further comments from the public. I'm going to close the public comment portion of the meeting. Councilors, any other questions from the councilors? Joe?
I just wanted to, I really wanted to make a comment after the mayor finished what he was talking about on the taxes. You know, the 90 cents is due to a decrease in property values, and that's still a loss by our residents.
I'm sorry, John. Would you just repeat that?
It's the 90, he was talking about the 90 cents
shift.
Part of the tax rate.
Because of the change
and the decrease in the property values, and that's still a loss of individuals. The bottom line is that the single family owners are experiencing $124 increase on a yearly basis, even other residents have had an increase if they're in an apartment or a condo or whatever, it's going up $78. You know, that's where we need to start looking at our budget and looking at ways that we can cut the budget. And we have to look at all of them, not just, I know we were hearing about fire and police and DPW, but schools have to be counted in that, because 80% of our budget on the local level is salaries, and schools are one of the biggest ones in the area of salary. And I appreciate the point that Mike was making when he came up and talked about the fact that we're not up to our levy limit, but it's exactly like a credit card, you know? I'm not gonna go out and, even I have credit cards and I could go out and use them and max them out, but I'm not gonna do that because that's not a smart thing to do. And there are some communities that are doing that. I just think it's, you know, the bottom line is that, you know, whether it's the 90 cents or the portion of the money, the $369,000 that we're going up in taxes, real taxes on the tax rate, the bottom line is that on my home, I'm going to experience an increase in the taxes that I'm paying. You know, $128, $124, whatever it is, and we have to put a stop to it. I mean, there has to be an end to it.
Thank you, Donna.
Well, I just don't know how many double slaps in the face this community can take, whether it's an increase in your tax bill or a kick in the head when you realize that you've just lost any equity you may have had, or worse, you're underwater. And I hear from the council that we've got to look at it. Yet at budget time, we weren't even willing to freeze at last year's numbers. So I don't know when we're going to get serious about we're going to look at it, because we have the rubber's met the road, the town's at tipping point, and I take no comfort in knowing that we have lots of room to tax you even more. That is like the most ridiculous statement I heard this evening, that our levy limit isn't there and we can tax you even more. So what are we supposed to sit down, shut up, and take it? I think this community has reached the end of its rope on the increased taxes. Since 2007, they've gone up an absurd amount, unlike any other community. So to say that we're all in the same boat and we're all in this together, we're not. We're charged more and our average incomes are less. We're not Newburyport. We are not Newburyport. We will never be Newburyport. Our incomes are $30,000 a year less than Newburyport. So I'm not quite sure when the council is going to put a line in the sand. I had hoped it was going to be last budget season. I look forward to the next budget season.
Let's do it. Any other councilors? Jim.
Thank you, Chairman Neal. Just a couple of things. Number one, to Mr. Bateau and his neighbor, I really respect what they set up there. I read your letter, actually, Mr. Bateau, prior to coming to this meeting, and I agree with a lot of it. I disagree with your statement there should be a split tax rate. Most of us on this council ran on the platform several years ago that we would restore the tax rate to a factor of one. I think when you stated you moved here in 2007, that was right about the time there was a lot of, it was problematic here in the town. A significant amount of folks were against the former council, the previous council's implementation of a split tax. There were several folks out against it. We had a recall. It wasn't good. It wasn't good for the city. It wasn't good for anybody. So what we did is we ran on a platform that we would restore that tax rate to a factor of one. We did it, and most of us were elected on that. As far as the budget is concerned, I'm a self-employed business person. Most of my family members are self-employed. We own a number of properties in town, so therefore we have the we're also burdened with the expense of owning several of these properties in town. And I can tell you right now, as a homeowner over on Monroe Street, I'm not happy to see my average or my tax bill increase any, as you aren't and your neighbor isn't, nor is anybody else here. I was not happy about the some of these contract negotiations, as Ms. Conti had indicated, happening after the fact, after we had already approved a budget for fiscal year 2013. In fact, I was just going over my October 9th municipal council meeting, October 9th municipal council meeting notes, and I believe it was the mayor. Mr. Mayor, please correct me if I'm wrong. I think it was either you or maybe even one of the other councilors had stated that with an impact of the four contracts that we had approved, that was the police, the fire, the OPEIU, and the AFL-CIO, that would be an increase of 25 cents on the tax rate. So if because we were going to realize a 90-cent increase as a result of $67 million in lost revenue in this town, the only amount in which we increased that tax rate was 21% or 21 cents, thank you, Councilor Neal, with an approximate tax increase on a $51 million budget of $369,000, then I would suggest that we use some of that free cash, and maybe this discussion, I know we're discussing the tax classification tonight, and I fully support, again, a factor of one, but I would recommend that we as a municipal council, not as the financial, but a recommendation to the municipal council as a finance committee body here this evening, at least consider taking some free cash, putting it into the budget for the amount in which we approved those contracts, $120,400 for the proposed or perceived increase of 25 cents. That would at least restore what we had approved here as a majority council, with the exception of one, on June 19th of this year. I don't know if anybody follows what I'm saying. I know I said a lot, but I think we should at least bring it back to what we as a municipal body approved back on June 19th, because there were some unexpected increases that it isn't fair that we say, well, we're going to increase the tax rate by that amount, okay, because we had everybody in here, all those who participated, Mr. Gonthier, Ms. Snow, the rest of the folks that came here and sat throughout those budget meetings. It isn't fair to, after the fact, say, well, we're going to increase it approximately another 25 cents. So I think we could use that amount of free cash that's been certified to offset, the increase by that amount. And to quote Councilor Ferguson back on the 9th of October as well, she indicated to both chiefs, Chief Gagnon and Chief Briquette, that she would expect them to be really looking a lot closer at their budget come budget time next year. And I told her then, as I stated, have written here in my notes, that I would hold her true to that, and she nodded in agreement. So that's just my take on all of this, but I do support a tax rate of one, a factor of one, but that we also reduce it by that 25-cent amount that we had perceived, that you, Mr. Mayor, had perceived back on October 9th, 2012. Thank you.
Would you like? Sure.
Let me clarify two things. One, as far as the 25 cents, I think that was Mr. Neal's numbers, but the increase in the $120,000 from the union contracts was not represented by the 25 cents. The total change as a result of the budget was represented by about 25 cents, and we now know 21 cents, which includes the 120,000. So that's one clarification. The other clarification, and a number of people have said this, about the contract negotiations and the folks not knowing when doing the budget. It is an order of the council passed some years ago that requires me to submit these union contracts separate, as a separate act with the council. So whereas in the past I have included contract raises in the budget, I was criticized for including it in the budget and was requested to do it separately from the budget. And now I think I'm being criticized for doing it separately from the budget. I'd be more than happy to include any future negotiations back in the budget, because I would prefer to do it that way. But that's a result of an order of the council some number of years ago to separate them. The union negotiations were not accomplished till after the budget was done, though the council was briefed throughout the entire budget deliberations that we were in negotiations on union contracts, but we didn't know where we would end up on the numbers. So clarification on how that process is done.
But the school part of the budget for those increases was put in their
the
budget.
School, right, and that's because the mechanism of establishing the school budget, they had to put money aside in the school budget.
And that figure was what, 280, Mike?
Yeah, about
280,000.
Yeah.
Yeah. For those of you out there, remember I made a statement earlier that we give the school department a certain amount of money. We do. We cannot control where they spend it, and at budget time we must give them the money they're going to have to operate through the school year. They are not able to come back to us necessarily for more money, and we are not able to take it away from them once we give it to them. So I just thought I would round out the discussion about how that mechanism works. Now, are there any further comments relative to the selection of a residential factor? If not, I would love to entertain a motion from someone.
Can I just make one last quick comment? There is, and I forgot about this, to Mr. Bateau and his neighbor, there's a 2002 Department of Revenue tax classification report available. I wish I was fumbling through my notes to see if I had it with me this evening. I'd be happy to give you a copy of it. But the Department of Revenue actually recommends that the legislature take a look at that law that had been enacted by our State House some time ago. I think it was 1988, maybe even before then. But to relook at that, reanalyze that, and reconsider possibly, revising that law so that it doesn't have, separate classifications, separate factors that can be assigned. So, our own Department of Revenue took a look at it. They think it could be considered borderline unconstitutional. That was taken right from the report itself. It's something you ought to take a look at. I'd be happy to provide you with a copy of it as well.
You can come. Happy to have you come up to the microphone. The people at home can't hear you.
They can't.
Mike, it's not my fault he won't speak into the microphone. I just want Mike to know that at home.
I apologize. It's just one quick question. Not being here when you guys reset you call it the value of one, what is it of one?
Factor of one.
What was the rate that you got when you fixed it and went to the factor of one? What was the rate then compared to now? That was all I knew.
Was it 1.2 or 1.15 or something?
If it's going to the rate, tax rate.
Right.
I forget around Mike, seven. Do you have it there?
It was the only year taxes didn't go up for the whole year.
Okay, I just didn't know. I haven't lived here much.
So in 2007, if it was a single rate, it would have been $13.45. It was for the residential $13.16, and for the commercial $15.47.
Yeah, it's over a $2 swing.
And then in 2008, if it was a single rate, it would have been $14.96, and the split rate, the residential was $14.6, and the commercial was $17.2. Factor was 1.2.
Was it 1?
Oh, no, 1.05.
1.5. I'm pretty confident. Yeah.
We want to one thing that included.
I just want to make a couple of comments. I think rounding out my first year being on the council and going through the budget process, I know it was a difficult decision. I know many of us took some tough votes, either for or against different portions of spending. I know there are some that I voted against, but at the same time, I thought it was important to make some investments at the city level too. So that's some of the decision making that we're going to have to live with as a council. And obviously, getting to this tax rate is where we are, and that's sort of the reality of how we deal with our budget. I get that. I think it's important to recognize, though, and it's a little frustrating as a councilor, that the path that we're on is just simply unsustainable. I mean, I think this rate is scary. I think the fact that we're over that $20 threshold sends a message. We've been talking all year about the need to brand in Amesbury. Who are we? We're a city. What's the type of business we want to attract? What is the storyline we're telling about the city? I'm very frustrated that we haven't done that. We've heard that there's an interest to do it. We haven't seen that happen this year. And I fear that this $20 number will be the brand for us that we probably don't want to be telling. And I'm relatively new to the city. I moved here 6 years ago. I know there's a lot of folks, at least in my situation, that came here because they do think the city is very charming and it's a great place to raise kids. They're worried about the tax rate. We hear about it pretty regularly. At the same time, a lot of us talk about growth, and we think that growth can get us out of this situation. I know we've stuck our neck out and put some money forward to enhance the Economic Development Office team to really kind of beef up their operation and really come up with a game plan for economic development, figure out the sectors that we're trying to bring into the city, tell our story. We're not there yet. I know we're working on that, but I think we as a council, and this is another frustration that I have, and I know it's a little distinct but tied in, we don't talk about these issues. We as a council do not talk about economic development activities. We don't talk about what we're doing to brand the city. We don't talk about what's happening with different sectors. There's hotel activity that's been stalled. We're, I think, expecting a lot of activity to happen on Route 110, Golden Triangle. We've had a lot of discussion with the DPW relocation, the Mill Yard, and frankly, I think we're putting a lot of eggs in that basket to hope that there's a big payday for all of us that will ultimately lead to a reduced tax rate. I hope that's the case, but frankly, I'm a little worried about it. And I think given the amount of time and energy that we focus on as a council, we just don't really get at a lot of these issues in a proactive way to get ahead of the curve, to deal with this stuff in a way that can really have an impact on this rate. I just worry that we deal with these pieces in a reactionary basis as they come to us in a very piecemeal fashion, in which the discussions are all very kind of choppy and segregated so that you can't talk about the issue as a whole. And I urge this council, I know it's a finance committee, but it's a council as a whole, I urge us to think more creatively and proactively about the big picture and our role as a council in addressing this issue. We have two committees. We have the ordinance committee and finance. We are a committee of the whole on finance, so we're the same exact body that represents the finance, the council itself. Ordinance is really sort of a committee focused on drafting and the legality of the paper and the ordinances that are before us. Outside of that, I think we need to be a lot more proactive on what we're doing to address this, because as I said in the beginning, it's an unsustainable path. And I feel very strongly that we need more of a game plan on the economic development side, on the job side, on the growth side, that frankly, as a council, I just don't feel comfortable with. And I think it's incumbent upon us to pay a little bit more attention to that. So that's sort of something that I want to get off my chest. I know that we've had a long year. We've done a lot of great stuff. We've, you know, some folks have voted for spending, held back on others. That's the nature of this debate and how it's played out over the year. And we are where we are now, but it's something that I would like to think about for us going forward for next year. So thank you. I appreciate the time.
Any further commentary?
I'll try to be brief. I know the issue is setting the tax rate. I never ran on split tax. I never would advocate for it. I grew up in this town. I don't think we have enough C&I, commercial and industrial parcels, never mind value, to truly offset the residential tax base. And I never have thought that. We've tried to make some changes in our zoning to create a little bit more growth. I think we're heading down the right path in that direction. I think people are running out of patience with that. And the very fact that we are a border community, you know, making Amesbury a retail haven is not probably ever going to be a reality unless there's, you know, a change at the state level in tax policy. So where does that leave us? With the parcels that we do have, we still can attract businesses and new growth in the C&I sector, I believe. We can do it by attracting large businesses to the town. It gets to Councilor Scorzoni's point about branding the community. I think that the mayor has a vision with that. I do believe that people are just running out of patience, given the economic conditions that we're living under. I see so many macroeconomic issues that we have that we just can't deal with at the local level. It is a tough time. I still believe in the economy, and I think it's tough for everyone. I can speak for myself in that regard, and my family. I can't speak for the other counselors. However, you know, at the end of the day, when times are tough, where do people go when they look for services? They go to the government, for better or worse. That's where we're at. So I just want to stress to people in the audience and at home, we do have a budget process. We have it every year. That's the time to come and make your choices about the services that we want. The schools are 55 cents on the dollar of the budget. That's 55% of the budget. You're going to cut schools, you got to go to the school committee meetings. 45 cents of that dollar lies with us. Yeah, we do vote the bottom line for the schools, but if you really want to get into the weeds on what they're spending their money on, they're a duly elected board. They need to hear the same things that we're hearing in their meetings. So, you know, I just want to leave it at that. It's a difficult position to be in here as a counselor. You know, I've been doing this for 4 years, and I never ran on the platform of lowering people's taxes. It just, and I beg anybody to come and say they're going to run on lowering people's taxes, the dollar amount that they cut, the check that they cut. Bring it on. I think it's a great thing. Elections have consequences. I think if they think that they can do that, I think it's a great thing. Come and show us where the cuts are going to be. That's all I have to say. Thank you.
Any other comments? I just want to make one final comment, just as a contextual thing. It's always great to have a goal. And if our goal was to reduce the residential tax rate by a dollar, what that would do would be to you'd have to get to a CIP tax factor of 1.25. The residential tax rate would dip to 1923, so that's about a dollar less. The commercial rate, however, goes to $25.45. That's a $6.20 spread. That's a heck of a lot of money all at once to whack the commercial industrial sector with. And I think, as you pointed out, this is not a time in an economy to increase costs like that to the commercial industrial sector either, never mind people. And given the experience in this town, we didn't have a $6 spread. I would hate to think of the hue and cry that would pour out from this community at the outrage of those charges. And it wasn't pretty then. And I expect that if we had to do this, it would be like an all-out war out there on us. So I just comment that that is the level of the shift that we would have to do to accommodate a $1 reduction in residential tax rate. I think that's ridiculous to impart that much increased cost on commercial industrial sector. And even though you may think they're you know, people that just sit around collecting cash from us because, you know, we want to shop there, I have to tell you, they won't be able to do business very long because you won't pay the price, you'll go somewhere else. They'll be out of business. That's the truth. Now, given that, I need someone,
to make a motion,
to be brave.
Please.
Thank you.
That a vote for a factor of one will establish a single tax rate for all classes of property in the city of Amesbury.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Second all around the house. Thank you, Donna. Any discussion? All those in favor? Thank you.
I have just one question.
Sure.
At the council meeting, we can have more discussion about...
Oh, absolutely. Okay. I mean, this is our recommendation to the council, remember?
I'm not just on the factor. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about other discussions that maybe Mr. Kelkors brought up with regards to maybe using some free cash for other uses other than what's planned right now. I mean, is that a discussion that we're going to have?
I'm not in charge of that meeting. However, I would tell you that at that meeting, we're going to be taking up this factor. If someone wants to have an ancillary discussion,
we'll ask the council president.
I have to tell
you, we would have to bring a measure forward.
Yeah, exactly. So I would suggest you bring a measure forward. However,
a money
you know, the tax rate is what has been set.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah, we just
the tax rate has been set. It's been approved by the state. Is that right?
No. We have to.
After we send this factor in.
Not until December.
After our December meeting.
After the council meeting.
Yeah. After the full council meeting approves it.
But as far as the setting of the rate, may I, Mr. Chair?
Sure. Oh, why not?
As far as the setting of the rate, and please correct me if I'm wrong, but we would have to bring either a separate measure or, you know, have
That's
the
exactly
assistant.
Correct. You'd have to have a separate measure. It would not be part of this.
For the transfer of free cash, too.
Mm-hmm. But the transfer of free cash has to come from the mayor. Doesn't come from the council.
That's right.
You can have a discussion.
So you can have a discussion all you want, but unless the mayor sends down a
bill. Well,
I
didn't want to belabor this, but yeah.
It's a separate measure.
Sorry.
Yeah, a separate measure. I mean, he has to initiate any money measure.
Number two, open space discount. Now, Mary, do you want to get up and give us your spiel on open space discounts?
We actually have no open space.
There you go.
Therefore, open space discount is not available.
So we need a motion to not have the establishment of an open space discount.
Right.
So could I have a motion?
So moved.
Thank you. Do I have a second?
Second.
Thank you. Any discussion? All those in favor? All those opposed? Donna, are you voting?
I'm sorry.
Sorry. All those in favor? All those opposed? Thank you.
Back now.
I know.
Go on.
And number three, the
residential exemption. Once again, Mary, you want to...
Just briefly explain it?
Please.
The
Well, the Board of Assessors recommends to not give a residential exemption. It is born within the residential class, so anybody's value that's over $254,000 absorbs that offset. So they're already valued higher, and then they're paying a higher value. So we do not recommend.
Okay. Everybody got that? Any questions? Could I have a motion?
I'd like to make a motion that we do not accept a residential exemption.
A second.
Any discussion? All those in favor? All those opposed? Looks unanimous. Commercial exemption. Same deal as the residential.
Absolutely.
Only in the commercial sector.
That's correct.
Do I have a motion?
I'd like to make a motion that we do not recommend to the municipal council commercial exemption.
Second. Any discussion? All those in favor? All those opposed? Thank you. And that brings us to 2012-093, vote to increase the exemption amount of qualified applicants. Mary, you want to speak on that a little bit?
Yes, that's the exemption we give to our elderly and veterans. And that exemption, this community historically in the past 10, 12 years has always doubled it based on how much their tax bill goes up. So if your tax bill went up $64, you can only get an increase of $64. You couldn't double that in exemption itself. And the council has done that. It's designed for the needy in the community, the elderly and the veterans.
Any questions, councilors? Do I hear a motion for the adoption of 2012-093?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Any more discussion? All those in favor? All those opposed? Bonnie, it looks unanimous. Thank you. 2012-094, to appropriate $114,000 of water retained earnings. The summary is an appropriation of $114,000 of water retained earnings to the fiscal year 2013 water budget. Michael?
This is a similar vote to what the council took last year. What we're doing is asking you to appropriate $114,000 of water surplus towards the water budget. What that will do is allow us to go back one step. Last year we had requested $214,000. This year we're requesting $114,000. We are not recommending a water increase in the rates this year, and we are not recommending a sewer rate increase either. Both of those funds have been self-sufficient this year. We're anticipating that the sewer budget will, current sewer revenues will cover this year's budget. This is also the step that we took to try to prevent the rates from peaking too quickly or too suddenly during the increase in water debt. And if you look, I had sent to the council just a little brief summary of the water fund this year. What we're doing here, if you look at the beginning of the first item, we had the fiscal 13 budget of $3.2 million. Compare it to the fiscal 12 budget. This is not new information. This was the budget as you voted. So the fiscal 13 budget is up $72,900 over the prior year. However, when you look at our fiscal 12 revenues, that's the year we just ended, they were $3.128 million. Compare that to the fiscal 13 budget that was authorized, and you'll see that there's an increase, a need for an increased revenue of $113,689. What I'm requesting is that we authorize the use of $114,000 of the water surplus that is available that will offset that increase. So we do not need to justify an increase in revenues to fund the current year budget. And just as a side note, if you look at the very bottom, we have for fiscal 13 the equivalent, as someone had said, the equivalent to free cash, but in the water system, it's water available, we have $637,000. If we use the 114, we still have an ending balance of $523,000. What we intend on doing is through the winter and the spring is monitor. We're still waiting for our final debt schedules on the water treatment plant, the $10 million loan that we have. Mm-hmm. That project is basically completed, but we're going through the closeout process now. Once we have those final debt figures, we'll build them into the fiscal 14 budget. We'll know that well in advance. We'll know it when we submit the budget to you folks. And at that time, we'll be ready to make a rate recommendation for the following fiscal year. So unlike in the past several years where we have instituted a rate increase on January 1st, I think we're very comfortable in saying that the first potential rate increase in water would occur at the earliest in July, so the beginning of fiscal 14. So the bottom line is, if you vote to transfer these funds, we will not be recommending a water increase.
Thank you.
Any questions, councilors?
This is a good thing. I mean, this is, I think we all agree this is a good move.
I was just trying to understand on the water surplus. Is that a cumulative number? In other words, what's shown as available in fiscal year 13?
Yes.
That's the entirety of the surplus. So in other words, there would have been money left over fiscal 12, rolled over. So now the...
That's correct. It's the same process as free cash.
Yep.
So that at the end of the year, you start over, you get recertified. However, the reality is, if you look in fiscal 12, we closed the year with a surplus of $518,000. We authorized $214,000 as the transfer, so it brought it down to $304,000. So then you just through calculations, you can see we built the surplus back up.
Right.
And every year it's recertified, just like free cash.
And my second question is there any, I know, I'm on a number of nonprofit boards, and the accountants talk about how large a surplus or reserve one should hold. Is there a rule of thumb for water systems?
Well, I don't know that there is. However, we're doing it for a specific reason. Right. We know this debt is coming online.
Right.
We're going to see an increase of some $400,000 in our debt payments over the next year or two. And that we've been working on this for, 5 years now,
right.
Similar to what we did to the sewer fund, which, once again, we've peaked on the debt. What's a little bit different from the taxes versus the water and sewer is with the completion of the water treatment plant, and a few years ago, the sewer treatment plant, that debt payment is nearly 50% of the entire budget. You know, the operating budget is small compared to it. It's not like the town where
right.
we have a $3 million debt budget and a $50 million general budget. So it's such a great percentage of this that it has a tremendous impact on the rate. So we started doing those increases. I mean, it's always good to have some
Absolutely.
Retained earnings built up, but this is very specific for this reason.
Right. Thank you.
And water and sewer is an enterprise fund.
Correct. Yep.
Thank you, Mike.
Any other questions, councilors? Anyone from the public? I'll close the public here. Councilors?
Can I make a motion?
Happy to have someone do that.
I'd like to make a motion to appropriate $114,000 of water retained earnings to the fiscal year 2013 water budget.
Did you second that?
I did second that to send to the municipal
to
council with the recommendation
for
mm-hmm. approval.
Any questions, comments by the councilors? Hearing none. All those in favor? All those opposed? Fabulous. Can I have a motion to adjourn?
Second.
Did you get that, Bonnie? All those in favor? All those opposed. Looks like everybody wants to go home.